So hi, this is Pankaj Singhal. I would say thanks to Finvent's network for taking this initiative and bringing an opportunity to share the experiences of as many experienced people here out. So yeah, I think, and as part of this event, this is a 1 hour event where for first half an hour to 30, 35 minutes, I'll share my thoughts on multiple topics as we move forward. In the end, we will take some questions, whatever best we can take. However, I can understand there are many questions which can be left unanswered. So what I'll do is I will try to answer as many questions as possible through the chat transcript, and we will publish that transcript with answers in a day or two in a follow-up to this event. So I think that should be a pretty exhaustive response on many things.
So yeah, thank you Pankaj bhai, and thank you Abhimanyu. Now Pankaj bhai, let's start with what this talk is about. So I would firstly like to ask you, what are your thoughts on common sense investing? It's a word thrown about, very easily these days, but what do you feel about common sense investing?
Yeah, so even I keep repeating this word quite a bit, many times on Twitter and on multiple social media platforms, that please follow common sense investing. Please keep your approach as simple. Do not be complex in your approach. So what I do mean by common sense investing. So in stock market, there are thousands of companies that we can find out, that we can go through to understand and find our own pick. However, as a very first principle of investment, we should know what we are investing into. We should know the kind of business that we invest into. So, what is common sense investing? Common sense investing is, let us start by what is stock market? It's a market of stocks. What is stock? Underlying entity of a stock is nothing but a business. So, common sense investing is nothing but start by understanding a business and what businesses that are easy to understand. There are hundreds of businesses. Some are easy to understand, some are very complex to understand. So, in my own definition of common sense investing, I would suggest to focus on those businesses which you can understand, businesses where you are spending your money directly as part of consumption on a regular basis, either on a daily basis, weekly basis, regular basis. But even if you look around yourself, if you look, understand your own growth over years, if you understand human growth over years, you will see growth always happens. Everybody grow. Some will grow slow, some will grow fast, but everybody grows over a period of time. So gradually, if growth has to happen, multiple businesses that will always keep growing without any doubt. So as a human being, if I am growing, I will spend my money continuously and in an increasing mode on multiple businesses like food, FMCG, technology, pharma, chemicals, home products, platforms. So there are many businesses that we are using on a day-to-day basis without which we cannot assume our life. We cannot assume our life without food, without FMCG, without mobile, without Amazon application in mobile, without pharma, without multiple home products. So if we cannot assume our life without these products, if you go little bit deep into these businesses, you would understand that you already know all these businesses. You do not need a third person to help you understand these businesses. So that is my exact point through common sense investing, that if you apply your own sense, if you apply your own mind where you are spending your own money, you will realize that your money is increasing the revenue of many businesses. And you know that over a period of time, let's say 10 years, if you used to spend 100 rupees 10 years back on certain item, you are actually spending 1,000 rupees on the same products today. So if you have grown your expenses over time on the same thing, respective businesses have grown through you. So this is what I mean by common sense investing. Look around yourself, look around the businesses where you are spending your own money, and go more into those businesses rather than finding stock into businesses which you do not understand. There can be many businesses which you do not understand, like cyclical businesses, like infrastructure businesses, like metal businesses. They are very tough businesses to understand because they depend on multiple cyclical factors, multiple policies, multiple regulations. So, if you keep things simple, you will actually understand and grow much better, and you are actually able to find right conviction into right stocks, right businesses. So focus more on business through common sense approach means focus more on businesses where you are spending your money directly into it. There can be 8 to 10 businesses which you can identify right away. And trust me, you do not need to go beyond that. There are ample names in those businesses, and those businesses are the businesses which will keep attracting premium valuations in times to come. Already this is happening, and it will keep happening. So yeah, Ayush, I think this is what I mean by common sense investing in brief. Because of the time, I am trying to concise my answer, but
No, definitely, Pankaj bhai. So, beautifully put. You don't have to be a jack of all trades if you can be a master of the few. So, beautifully put by you. So, Pankaj bhai, next I would like to ask you if you could, share some of your mistakes in your investing journey with us and what you've learned from those mistakes and some do's and don'ts that you've collected along that journey.
So mistakes are actually part of life, to be honest. If we are focusing towards growth in our life, in our investment journey, we are bound to do mistakes. We should never feel worried that we will commit mistakes. So let us avoid this. Rather, face mistakes, do mistakes, learn from it, and keep moving on. Ultimately, objective is to make sure that we are not repeating the same mistakes. That's the most important thing. So, in my own investment journey over many, many years, I definitely have done many mistakes, very, very dumb mistakes, very complex mistakes too, but I have done many mistakes. So, I can take some examples based on the time. So, I would strongly suggest to everyone that never ever go with leverage, never ever go with borrowed money. Investment has to be done through earned money, through saved money, but never through borrowed money. Very important thing. And even if you want to take leverage, you should know what you are doing, how much, what is your risk profile, what is your risk capacity. So, leverage can be very dangerous if you are at a very low risk capacity. It can literally take you down to zero, in fact, negative net worth. So, strict no-no in my view to leverage. And there are many more mistakes. In fact, I also took a mistake of taking leverage, but I realized very early in my part of life. And since then, I have never ever taken it. And I am, trust me, it's been a real good lesson from it. So, beyond leverage, I would say never react based on events, never react based on market-wide sentiments. So, events do nothing but events create opportunities. Never think that if there is a crash happening in the market, across the market, do not react. This is doing nothing but this is actually creating opportunities. This is a time to enter, not to exit, depending on what you understand, depending on the value of the business. So, Events do nothing but they create opportunities, but never react in panic on downside, never react in euphoria on upside. On both sides, you have an opportunity to either enter or to exit, but do not act other way. Similarly, let's say you are, another thing is where I did mistake is, let's say I am liking something today. I bought big quantity right away. So that is what I would say, always build your allocation gradually towards upside. Take your time, build your allocation with fundamental milestones gradually over 2 quarters, 4 quarters, but take your time. Do not go enter into anything right away. Similarly, averaging out. Do not catch falling knives. You never know. You have some conviction on certain business. However, there can be something going wrong behind the scenes in the company, which you do not know. So do not try to catch falling knives. I would always suggest, always go by the numbers. Try to understand if there is really something going on in the business behind the scenes. Otherwise, there is no need to catch falling knives. And in terms of over analysis, very, very important point. Earlier, I used to go through multiple ratios, multiple parameters in terms of fundamental analysis. However, that does nothing but that makes you leave the opportunity rather than using the opportunity. So over analysis is meant to reject the opportunity. It is not meant to use the opportunity. Keep analysis simple. Focus on important aspect of business. Focus on growth. Focus on value. All in all, focus on business. Simple. So these are the very few points based on which I would say take your time. Keep reviewing yourself gradually. With every upside milestone of achievement in your growth, keep reviewing yourself. Understand that, are you into right businesses? Are you doing all things right? Do not try to be a perfectionist. Do not borrow convictions also. So even if you want to borrow something from other people, take that name, but analyze it yourself. Understand that business on your own. The more you depend on others to build your own portfolio, I think gradually you would feel more, you will act more in regrets rather than more in convictions. So this is where I would say keep reviewing yourself. In fact, what I will do is I have a very long thread of mistakes that I have done in my past, based on which I also have lessons realized from those mistakes. There are 25-30 points. I will share after this event with everybody, and that can be very useful for.
Sure. Thank you. Thank you very much, Pankaj bhai. You know, very enlightening answer. Now, before I proceed, I would just like to answer two or three queries that are coming up constantly in the chat. The first query is regarding Pankaj bhai's video. So, guys, this is not an event wherein we would be sharing a certain presentation during the event, or wherein Pankaj bhai's video would be on or our video would be on. This is simply a video podcast wherein Pankaj bhai would be speaking, we would be answering the questions, and then after the podcast, you guys would be answering the questions to Pankaj bhai. Then I have a second query from a few people that the audio was not clear during the first half of the presentation, and the audio was not clear during even it is not clear right now. So now this event is being recorded and the audio at our end is pretty clear. So even if the audio is not clear at your end, this event will be uploaded on our YouTube channel and Pankaj bhai will be sharing this event. So you don't have to worry about the audio aspect of it. The last and final request that I would like to make to everyone is please, please switch off your cameras, because you know while Pankaj bhai is talking to you, he's sharing his journey with you, he's sharing all the facts with you. So he is in a certain mindset. So you know it disturbs his mindset while cameras are switching off, switching on at the same time. So I would just request if you guys could be patient with us for just 60 minutes and be on mute and switch off your cameras. That it would really you know help us out. That is all. Now we'll proceed to the third question. So Pankaj bhai, can you tell us a little bit about your multi-bagger journey? And if possible, quote one example.
Yeah, sure. So multi-bagger journey is easy as well as tough, I would say. So easy in the sense that there can be many stocks that we can find out in an early part of the journey, something which is trading at 2 PE, 5 price to earnings multiple, 10 price to earnings multiple. However, what we need to understand while picking such undervalued stock is this business sustainable? Is this business predictable? By predictable, what I mean is, can we predict the numbers going forward in that business if this business is growing, if this company is growing? So, yes, let's say something is trading at 5 PE today. There can be two aspects. One is, why this stock is trading so cheap? There is something wrong. Another aspect can be, this stock is trading so cheap, can this go to expensive valuations in future? So through one aspect, we are actually doubting the company and we are analyzing it to reject the company. However, through another aspect, we are trusting the company right away. There can be multiple reasons that company is trading undervalued, but we are trusting the business, we are trusting the company, we are trusting the company fundamentals. So at that point of time, I understand that company is trading cheap, company is trading undervalued, and I am trying to understand what kind of triggers can come up in future which can re-rate the company towards next level of valuations. So usually in my own journey, where I have picked many stocks in last 5, 6, 8 years, where stocks have gone up 10 times, 20 times, even 100 times. So those stocks used to trade at literally throwaway valuations. And I am trusting the company. I am trying to understand the business. And I am trying to understand if company can sustain its numbers as a first thing, and can company grow on top of those numbers in future. So if these kind of fundamental milestones keep happening quarter on quarter in terms of business performance, in my experience, I can strongly say that if there is an undervaluation, value catch up will happen. But nobody knows when will it happen. It can happen sooner, it can happen later. Value catch up always happen, but that happens gradually with every fundamental milestone. Ultimately, investor, right investor and stock market, they know when to re-rate a stock. They need to know, have a history of predictability and sustainability. Based on that, in my experience, I can say between 8 to 16 quarters, between 2 to 4 years, stock usually complete its multi-bagger journey, depending on the growth, depending on the undervaluation, depending on the future business potential. So if I can tell you some names as part of as examples towards this point, there was a stock, Shri Jagdamba Polymer. I picked it way back. I don't remember the exact year when I picked it, but it used to trade at 2 PE, 2 price to earnings multiple, just 2. However, since then, earnings grew, valuations grew, valuations multiple grew. So, split adjusted price, I bought it at 3 rupees. The same stock is 600 rupees today. So at that time, stock was actually 30 rupees, 10 rupee face value. Today, if we adjusted it per split, it was 3 rupees, 1 rupee face value. Today, it is 600 rupees, 1 rupee face value. 200 times over, I think, 6 or 7 years, something like that. But my point is, it was trading at 2 PE at that time. It is trading at 20 PE today. If I remember, there was around 17 or 18 EPS at that time, means 1.7, 1.8 EPS at that time. Today, the same is 30 EPS. So earnings grew, valuations multiple grew. See, I can quote one more example right away, depending, I think we have time. Bharat Rasayan. So I picked it at around 350 rupees, if I remember approximately. Around at 350 rupees, it was trading at 5 PE multiple. EPS was 70 rupees, somewhere around that. Today, EPS is approximately 400. Price earnings multiple is almost 25. Stock has gone to almost 10,000 rupees. So from 350 to 10,000 over 5 6 years, earnings grew, valuations grew. So when I picked those stocks, I never doubted why they are cheap. I trusted the business, I trusted the management, I trusted the numbers, and I looked into the future that these companies are into right businesses. Number one thing, they are having very, very low equity. They are having very good numbers in terms of all the fundamental parameters. So, but at that time, I definitely ignored the ROCE or something like those numbers, which usually stay variable as per the business phases. All these ratios will mislead you more number of times rather than help you during in finding a multi-bagger stock. These ratios will help you when you are finding a compounding story. These ratios will not help you when you are trying to find multi-bagger stories. Multi-bagger stories will have very variable ratios, very variable fundamental parameters. Even debt can go up right away, and debt can come down also in few years. ROCE can stay. Can be 10, can be 40, can be 20 again. You never know, because companies are into high growth phase. So during those phases, you just have to trust the business. You have to focus on the business potential, sustainability, numbers, predictability, and accordingly keep giving it time. If I tell you, if I am holding Bharat Rasayan, let's say 5 6 7 years, over these years, at least 10 to 15 times there have been extreme noises on stock, that it has this problem, it has that problem, multiple. So I always ignored those noises. I always trust the business, and ignoring noises means I just have to keep giving it time as well as space. What I keep repeating on Twitter is give time, give space to your conviction, because giving time is one thing, everybody understand. However, giving space is more. You discuss certain stock with more number of people, you will get equal number of viewpoints. Equal number of viewpoints means it will always keep you confused whether you are into right stock or you are into wrong stock. So more the confusion, you will keep entering in and out of the stock, and you are not going to ride a peaceful journey. So I think I am able to pass on my message regarding multi-bagger journey, that trust the business, trust the fundamentals, do not doubt. However, look into the future by giving it time and space.
I think Pankaj bhai, for those people who carefully listened to the last few lines of what you said of this answer, you actually gave them a blueprint of how to, you know, find a multi-bagger. Now, Pankaj bhai, there was this book, Thinking Fast and Slow by Daniel Kahneman, and he described tunnel vision bias, and he said that what you see is all there is. So, coming on to that, I would like to ask you, you know, there are always hopes and there are then always the facts. So, what would be your view on hopes versus facts in stock markets?
Yeah. So, again, this is also related to multi-bagger thing, multi-bagger journey as well. So, hope versus facts. So, what I mean exactly here is, I would say, based on my own approach of fundamental investing, business-based investing, for me, what matters? Business matters. If business matters, business performance matters. If business performance matters, numbers matters. So numbers are facts. Numbers are what we can see as of today. And based on numbers, we can stay peacefully into the business if there is a value. However, there is another aspect of looking at things from that something is almost zero today or in very, very early phase of its story. However, we are expecting something good to happen in future. So that good can happen in future, but future is yet to come. So you never know. Some circumstances change the situation and that future never comes up for that story. So that is where I call it as a hope-based story. So you can be in hope-based story if you really know completely in and out of the things. However, that is more of insider things rather than knowing things as an investor. So as an investor, believe more on facts, rely less on hopes. By believing more on facts, what you are doing is you are actually believing more on numbers. Accordingly, you are trying to understand whether there is a value that exists as of today. And if there is a value existing as of today, you can actually keep holding that opportunity with much more peaceful mind. If there is no value as of today, but there are hopes in future, means you are expecting value to generate in future, that means you are actually in hope story. You will have to give a lot of time and space to that story. And you never know if that hope will materialize in future or not. You are having trust that hope will materialize. However, you do not know with surety that will it happen, because circumstances change. It can delay the things, it can push things much further away. So be into stocks where there is value as of today as a first point, and then look into the growth towards future, look into the hopes towards future. So I gave two examples in earlier question, Sri Jagdamba Polymer and Bharat Rasayan. There were hopes in future that triggers will come up, business will grow, business will sustain and as well as grow. However, when I picked up, there were numbers already, and based on those numbers, those stocks were trading at very, very undervalued price earnings multiple. One was trading at 2, one other was trading at 5 PE. So there were good numbers. In spite of that, those were trading undervalued. So I picked stocks because they had value. I kept riding the stock till there was value and till I saw growth in numbers in future. So hope versus fact. So in my view, I will stress on few points that you should know that there will always be some value left on the table while riding this journey. So otherwise, stock will keep getting ready for a correction during a multi-bagger journey. Value of a stock will always get adjusted based on business sustainability, based on numbers predictability. Another point is, I would say, in terms of hope versus facts, you should know that based on facts, it doesn't mean that every company will attract premium valuations right away. Small company will attract small undervalued valuations, low valuations. But as company grow bigger, as company is sustaining in its business, and as company is showing its power to show its own business moat, it will keep attracting new valuations gradually. It will not happen overnight. It will always happen gradually. So I would clearly say, believe more in facts. Do not get carried away in hopes. Believe in fundamental breakout. I can see there is some time. I can give you one very quick example of ITC, one of our very, very highly discussed stock on social media. So on September earnings, I was very sure that there is a clear fundamental breakout in the numbers, in the business performance. So my point is, believe in facts. As soon as the facts emerged, patience is done in the stock. Now stock is ready to catch up on the value because there is a clear fact in terms of numbers. There was a turnaround in numbers in terms of non-cigarette revenue. As soon as those numbers got published, stock is up from 170 to 230 in less than 3 months. So 35% returns in less than 3 months in a very, very liquid stock, it's excellent returns. But I am not suggesting that ITC is a good buy or not. That's a different discussion. However, my point is, as soon there can be two things. You could have hold ITC for many years and kept patience that these numbers will come in future. Another aspect is you could have tracked the business performance, and as soon as you feel that yes, now there are right numbers to support next level of valuations, you can buy at that time. So you bought based on new facts, you got the returns much faster than holding just in anticipation of hope.
Wonderful, wonderful, Pankaj bhai. Now, Pankaj bhai, at the time we are doing this podcast, so the Nifty from its March low is almost high at around 97%. I know it is a very cliched question to ask you, but what do you feel is the future of the stock markets for the next 3 to 5 years? Or rather, let's say the next 5 years going from here, from this point, what do you feel is the future of the next 5 years? And I know this is a very cliched question to ask you.
Okay, so I was not aware that Nifty is up 97% since March lows, because to be honest, I do not track Nifty too closely or indices too closely. But yes, March was a panic reaction based on coronavirus event. However, as soon as markets and investors realized that ultimately it's an event which will end up somewhere and human growth will come back with a bang. So everything went up across the globe in every market. So there is a new optimism in the air. However, over last few months, things have changed aggressively in favor of India, in favor of Indian stock market, in favor of Indian businesses, in favor of Indian entrepreneurship, in favor of even Indian consumer. So my point is, I think to answer directly to your question that what is the potential of Indian stock market over the next 2 to 5 years, I would say Indian market has potential to lead the world markets over next 2 years in a very, very big way. Do not underestimate the power of investor consumer at this moment. I think India is at the center stage of the world where India is becoming हब फॉर मेनी मेनी बिजनेसेस जस्ट बिकॉज इंडिया हैज अ पॉपुलेशन ऑल्सो. सो बाय पॉपुलेशन इट मीन वट आई मीन इज इंडिया हैज अ कंज्यूमर ऑल्सो. सो मैन्युफैक्चर इन इंडिया, कंज्यूम इन इंडिया, बोथ थिंग्स इज ऑलवेज प्रेफरेबल फॉर एनी बिजनेस. इफ समबडी वॉन्ट्स टू सेटअप एनी बिजनेस इन एनी कंट्री एंड ही वुड प्रेफर इफ देयर इज अ लोकल कंज्यूमर ऑल्सो इन दैट कंट्री. सो अर्लियर इट यूज टू बी चाइना, हाउएवर बिकॉज ऑफ कोरोना वायरस एंड बिकॉज ऑफ अ परसेप्शन टुवर्ड्स चाइना बींग बिकॉज ऑफ देयर इज अ नेगेटिव परसेप्शन टुवर्ड्स चाइना. सो मेनी बिजनेसेस आर शिफ्टिंग देयर बेस टू इंडिया एंड अदर कंट्रीज. हाउएवर इंडिया विल टेक बल्क ऑफ मेनी बिजनेसेस वेयर देयर आर कैपेबिलिटीज, कैपेसिटीज एंड कंज्यूमर. सो आई थिंक इंडियन स्टॉक मार्केट विल लीड द वर्ल्ड इन मैनी आस्पेक्ट्स एट द सेम टाइम. वट आई फील इज 2021 एंड 2022 आर द टू आर गोइंग टू बी टू वेरी वेरी बिग ईयर्स वेयर वेल्थ क्रिएशन कैन बी ह्यूज. दैट इज वन थिंग. हाउएवर फ्रॉम 23 अंटिल 25 नेक्स्ट 3 ईयर्स आई फील इंडियन स्टॉक मार्केट विल मेच्योर मच मच फास्टर देन एनी वन कैन इमेजिन. इन माई व्यू एवरीथिंग वेयर देयर इज अ बिजनेस पोटेंशियल ऑफ फॉर एवर विजिबिलिटी. फॉर बाय फॉर एवर इट डजेंट मीन 100 ईयर्स और 200 ईयर्स. बाय फॉर एवर आई जस्ट मीन अंटिल वी कैन सी ऑन अवर सेल्व. सो ऑल दोज बिजनेसेस विल अट्रैक्ट प्रीमियम वैल्यूएशंस इन ऑल प्रोबेबिलिटी बाय 2025. देयर यू विल नॉट बी एबल टू फाइंड स्टॉक्स बेस्ड ऑन स्क्रीनर, बेस्ड ऑन रिजल्ट, बेस्ड ऑन नंबर्स. यू हैव टू इन्वेस्ट ओनली बेस्ड ऑन बिजनेस. राइट नाउ यू कैन फाइंड स्टॉक्स बेस्ड ऑन अर्निंग्स, बेस्ड ऑन स्क्रीनर टूल, बेस्ड ऑन मल्टीपल मीडिया, मल्टीपल फॉर्मूलाज. हाउएवर आफ्टर 2 ईयर्स आई फील इट्स ओनली बिजनेस दैट यू हैव टू लुक इन टू. द वे यूएस मार्केट्स बिहेव एज ऑफ टूडे, इंडियन मार्केट्स विल बिहेव आफ्टर 2022. दैट इज माई व्यू. आई कैन बी कंप्लीटली रॉन्ग, आई कैन बी राइट, यू नेवर नो. हाउएवर बेस्ड ऑन माई एक्सपीरियंस ऑफ मल्टीपल इकोनॉमीज, मल्टीपल मार्केट्स ओवर लास्ट 20+ ईयर्स, आई थिंक दिस इज हाउ इंडियन मार्केट्स विल मेच्योर एंड इंडियन मार्केट्स आर गोइंग टू मेच्योर मच फास्टर.
So, Pankaj bhai, a quick follow-up question to that question, and this resonates a lot with the one I asked. So, if we are saying that the Indian market will mature a lot in the next 5 years, do you feel, and you don't have to answer this question if you don't want to, that the returns we might get from Indian companies, or rather investing in India as an individual, may match up or rather beat in some sense to the returns we may get investing in, say, NASDAQ or the companies listed there?
Tough to answer, tough to predict actually, because this is more of prediction. However, what I can say is if we are in right businesses, right companies with some sort of undervaluation, I think many Indian names can beat US businesses in terms of returns. There is a scope because, to my understanding and experience, I can see there are many, many companies which are trading still much undervalued and they have potential to re-rate literally multi-bagger times over next 2 to 5 years.
Thank you very much, Pankaj bhai. Thank you a lot for giving us your time. And with that, I would like to end the podcast with Pankaj bhai, and we would now straight away move on to the Q&A. So you guys can list down all your questions in the chat box. And I would hand over to Abhimanyu. Abhimanyu, you can just take out all the questions and ask Pankaj bhai all the questions one by one. And whatever questions we are not able to answer up till 6:30, we will be making a PDF document of all the questions from the time we started the meeting today. And we will try to get an answer to most of these questions, and we will share the questions with all of you. Even this podcast will be shared on our YouTube channel, the link of which would be available on our Twitter handle, as well as we'll ask Pankaj bhai to share the podcast link with you.
Perfect. I think that was a beautiful, beautifully put. Whatever Pankaj sir had to say, it was very helpful to me. I have already noted down the questions. There are a lot of questions already. I don't think we'll be able to take all of them. So I think without wasting any more time, I'll go ahead and take the first question. The first question we have is from Ms. Poonam Mishra. She is asking you, how do you start analyzing a company?
Business. Very, very simple thing is business. So first of all, I need to know which business I want to invest. So let's say I want to invest in pharma business. So within pharma business, next point would be I want to pick certain companies where they are trading cheap. So I would go either through a screener or through results, and I would see which companies are trading at much undervalued valuations in comparison to leader companies in the same sector. So to just repeat the answer, I start with the business which I can understand. Very simple.
Perfect, perfect. I think that answers the question, short and simple. Okay, the next question is we have is from Mr. Anshu. He says, what do you think will be the effect of budget on healthcare industry?
Everything is literally positive, I would say. Anyway, I think these budgets, looks very good in now. In announcements, looks very good in big numbers. However, nobody knows how much we follow up on all those budget announcements over time. So ultimately, healthcare is a sector which no government can ignore, especially after COVID. So healthcare has to grow either through government or through private investment. So I think we have a trust in the capacities and capabilities of India. I would say healthcare sector has a very long way to go, and India will again lead the sector for many countries, in fact.
Perfect. Okay. Up next, we have a question from Mr. Rohan Kamath. Do you think IPOs can ever be a multi-bagger way of investing?
No. Definitely no. So IPOs, that's a very different discussion. I would not like to speak about that here on this media, on this platform, but IPOs are managed very differently. That is not a discovered price, that is a managed price. So IPOs can give you huge returns in shorter time frame. However, in my view, that is not an investment, that is more of speculation.
I feel the same way. I think that's the perfect answer for that. Okay, up next we have a question from Mr. Vivek Gandhi. Do you also follow technical analysis along with fundamental analysis for picking the companies you invest into?
No, I am zero in technical. I do not understand any charts. And this doesn't mean I am saying that technical analysis is bad. In fact, I do have many friends who are doing very good based on technical analysis. However, my only point here to say is technical analysis is based on price and volume. However, business-based approach is based on pure business, numbers, and value. So what is stock? Underlying entity of a stock is nothing but a business. In technical analysis, we are doing everything, but we are not understanding the business. We are ignoring the business. So even if you are doing good in technical, you are doing good in fundamental, but my experience is fundamental, based on business based approach of investing, we can stay peacefully during events, we can stay peacefully during market wide corrections, and we can keep holding the stock just because we understand the business and underlying value, underlying parameters. That is the only point I would say. So I am zero in technical, and I still do not want to learn technical because I feel I am doing better in my own approach.
Perfect, perfect. I think the same way that you should continue doing whatever works for you. Okay, up next, we have a question from Mr. Malay. He says, how do you analyze the management of a company?
Nobody can analyze it. Very simple. So even I do not, I have no means how to analyze the management of a company, because it is a very subjective thing. If I tell you I am a very good person, I will take your stock from 100 to 10,000 rupees. Talking is easy. Walking the talk is what matters. So for me, the only way I see that management is good, it should reflect in numbers. It should reflect in growth. It should reflect in future vision as well as achieving that vision of the company. So fine, company says a lot of things in annual report. Company says a lot of things in investor presentations. Company says a lot of things on media, social media. However, only few companies you will realize in the end that they are, what they are saying in all those things, they are actually reflecting the same in the numbers every quarter. So I am a numbers person. I am a person who believe more in facts. So I will believe what management is walking the talk. So every quarter, if management is showing the numbers, if business is showing its performance, I would say management is actually good. That is the only way for me to understand if management is good.
Perfect. Okay. Up next, we have a question from Mr. Shiva Kumar. If you were to answer this question about common sense, what was the common sense in Sri Jagdamba Polymer when you picked the company at that time?
So it was two things. One is business and another was value. So in terms of business, common sense is Sri Jagdamba Polymer was into jute, something related to bags. At that time, there was a good pressure on plastic products. So that was a proxy to plastic products, plastic bags. So Sri Jagdamba Polymer could get pushed to its business through this plastic noise. Hence, I was just based on this thing, it came to my mind that yes, this business will easily grow. There is no doubt on it. So simple, just based on this thought, I invested in that business, one thing. And another point is, it was trading at very, very cheap valuations, 2 PE stock. So a business which can grow, which is sustaining in its past, it is available at 2 PE. For me, it was a pure common sense that business has potential and business has value. Let me buy it. Simple.
Perfect. Okay. Up next, we have a question about diversification. This is a question from Mr. Indra, and he says that should we have a part of our portfolio exposure towards geographic allocation? Suppose we are talking about US-based companies.
So I can say that since last 1 year, people must be very excited to move towards NASDAQ stocks, because stocks like Amazon, Google, Tesla, they have given huge returns over time. However, it makes sense to diversify, but do not diversify just because you are seeing that there are returns coming there. Returns will come everywhere. In fact, in comparison, percentage returns will happen much better in India. However, even if you want to invest, it makes sense. It's always great to diversify at any point of time. Diversification is always advisable in my approach and in my experience. However, diversify only into something if you understand that something, whatever stocks or whatever markets you are trying to diversify, be it Dow Jones, Nasdaq, China market, whatever markets, you should know how those markets behave, how those stocks behave there. So based on that, you should diversify. Do not diversify blindly. Diversify into something which you understand.
Perfect. Okay. Up next, we have a question from Mr. Shiva. He is, how often do you go and look back at your investments?
Every quarter.
Okay.
So for me, numbers matter. So I review every of my stock that I am holding every quarter. Based on the numbers, I review whether I am in right stock, and I usually keep holding on till I understand that numbers are on right track. So I review every quarter. That doesn't mean I am exiting every quarter, but I am reviewing every quarter for sure. So every quarter I revisit my investments thoroughly.
Perfect. Okay. Okay. This is a. I don't know if this is a good question to ask or no, but feel free to avoid it. This is about the valuations about platform businesses in India. Do you think they are something to look into?
In my view, no. So valuations matter only to a point where businesses are in an early stage. Once businesses grow, sustains, and once business becomes part of our life in some way, then beyond that, valuations do not matter, at least in these times. And you never know, even in future. So businesses like platform-based businesses, even if you compare businesses like Amazon, Google, Tesla, and in India, businesses like Route Mobile, Affle, IndiaMart, all these businesses which are platform-based. So these businesses are easing the life of either other businesses or consumer in multiple ways. So since these are becoming a must part of business or consumer, these businesses are going beyond valuations parameter. These businesses will keep sustaining their premium valuations till the point there is no significant competition to their own business, to their own way of moat. So I think platform-based businesses will go beyond valuations. You can see where IndiaMart, all these companies are trading, Naukri.com. So, and they may keep trading at premium valuations because investors know that these are trustworthy businesses for a longer duration.
Perfect. I think we can all see as investors the valuations which they're currently trading at. Okay. Next up, we have a question from Mr. Indra. Okay, no, I think that I've read the name wrong. This is a question from I believe it's from Mr. Indra. He says CDMO versus API, which sector do you think will have better traction in the next coming 10 years?
Both actually, because see, CDMO is like a contract development and manufacturing organization. CDMO, CMO, CRAMS, all three are one word for a all three all these are three different words for a single business, contract manufacturing. And contract manufacturing will remain in demand, especially in India, because transition from China is one thing. It is happening big time. And whatever companies are growing their capacities and capabilities both at the same time, those companies will have strong potential to grow in CDMO space. One thing. In terms of API is a very, very must business as part of pharma. Without API, there does not exist any medicine, any tablet, any syrup, anything. So API is a research-based business. generic medicine is not a research based business. So API will always attract good valuations, good investor attention. So in my view, to answer to your question, both CDMO and API will have a lot of scope to grow in future, and companies which are already doing well in these two areas of pharma, I think they will attract a lot of premium valuations in times to come.
Great. I think that should answer it. He's already saying thanks a lot. Okay, so we have, I think we'll just take a couple of more questions. I think two more should be enough. We have already taken more than 1 hour of Pankaj's time. Okay, so the first question which I'm seeing is from Mr. Gautam. He says, what are the implications of more and more retail participation in the markets, especially when they do churning?
So this is happening for the very first time in India. However, this is where my point was in my earlier discussion, that Indian market will mature much faster in times to come. So I'll just take some time, some little more thoughts on this answer, that if you look at 10 years back, no amount of data was available to any one of us. However, if we look at today, we have all kind of data available to us in every means. Right away, whatever data we need for any company, it is available immediately. Everybody is tracking same data in different ways. So point is, this will retail participate, retail will keep getting educated, retail will get more aware than before. So again, within retail, there are different population which will keep churning their portfolio because they do not want to keep patients for even few months. However, within retail, there will be other investors also who want to keep patients, who want to behave more as matured investors. So that maturity will come with time. Ultimately, every retail will grow. Some will grow slow, some will grow fast. So in early phase of this growth of retail, there will be pressure when retail will churn their portfolios much faster. However, gradually, when retail will attract their own threshold level, they will also stop churning their portfolio not that often. So beyond that point, I think maturity will come much faster, low churning, but every retail will also want to wait for longer duration depending on multiple aspects of future. So I think as of today, yes, you may feel pressure that retail is churning their portfolio. So wherever there is more retail holding, that stock may not do good. However, trust me, the same stock will do much, much better in future, because this churning is making that stock weak today, but this is getting absorbed by very strong hands at the other end. So every stock has its own phase. It will keep growing depending on the value.
Perfect. I think it is already 6:30. I'll just ask you this one last question, and then I think we can end the meeting. For all the people whose questions did not get answers, we have the entire chat transcript. We'll be giving it to Pankaj sir, and later on in a couple of days, he will be getting back with the answers on probably on his Twitter. We'll be leaving the Twitter link in the description. I don't think anybody, we have to tell anybody about the link. So the last and final question is from Mr. Anshu, and he says that if you were to name certain sectors which are coming into your view for the next 10 years, which would be those sectors?
I think chemicals, pharma, and technology. Yeah, so these are the businesses where with that will keep getting attention. But I think India is at a point where multiple sectors related to even infrastructure may do good. But I will personally focus more on pharma, chemicals, technology. So in technology, it can be platform, it can be innovation, it can be IT services, depending on where, which company is into right business within technology. So pharma, chemicals and technology, I would keep as my first preference for next 10 years. As a next league, I would keep my preference on consumer linked. Directly consumer linked means food, FMCG, home products, tires maybe. So all these businesses.
Perfect, perfect. I think with that, we can probably end the meeting. Any ending notes you would like
Pankaj
to give
bhai,
all of
before
us?
Sorry, please continue, Abhimanyu. Yeah.
Any ending note for all of us, sir?
So, first of all, thank you so much to everyone for listening patience, listening with patience to me. And thank you to Finments, Ayush and Abhimanyu for arranging this event and helping me share my experience. And as a note, I would say that I think move beyond past, look into the future. And future is where we need to look into if we want to invest in stock market. So stock market has a lot of potential only if you are able to look into the future. If you look into the past, you are actually looking into the negatives. You are actually trying to understand the history, how stock market has destroyed wealth in terms of few stocks. However, look at positive side. Look at always the simple things, simple stocks, simple businesses that have created a lot of wealth over years. So be positive. I think India has a lot of potential from here. Build your position, build your portfolio, position your portfolio very right towards future, towards where India can grow. So next 2 to 5 years, there is immense potential to build huge wealth in my view. I think that is what I am betting on, but that is where you should look into. And keep it simple. Keep it simple. Again, one more point is, apply common sense investing. Keep things simple. Trust businesses. Do not doubt businesses. Trust them. Be with the people who are helping you achieve your goals. Do not be with the people who are creating doubts in your mind against different people. So be positive in every aspect. You will definitely grow sooner or later. That's it. I think I am done. Yeah, Ayush.
Yes, Pankaj bhai, firstly, I would like to thank you for giving us 1 hour of your time today. And next, I would like to thank all the attendees. They were on mute for almost over an hour, 10 minutes. So thank you guys for being present today. I have a small request to all the attendees. If you liked the presentation, just leave a small feedback to us on our Twitter handle and to Pankaj bhai on his Twitter handle. I have shared it in the chat window. And the recording of this entire podcast would be uploaded on our YouTube channel. So you can go and you can subscribe on our YouTube channel, or you cannot subscribe. It is totally up to you. And we would share the PDF of all the questions on our Telegram group. Now, I would be sharing the PDF with Pankaj bhai also. So he will also be sharing a separate PDF on Twitter with all of you. Or if possible, he will be making a thread on it, whatever is, more comfortable with Pankaj bhai. So I again thank all of you. And I thank Pankaj bhai for, this lovely session. It would not have been possible either, without the speaker or the attendees. So with that, I would like to end today's session. So Pankaj bhai, if you have any ending notes, otherwise we can end today's session.
All the very best. Yeah, that's my ending note. All the very best. Thank you so much to everyone. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you so much, sir, for coming.
Thank you, Pankaj bhai. Thank you very much.